Now, we've been in Matthew 18, which is, you know, the conflict section, the conflict passage. And we're kind of getting to the end of it, wrapping up a few core ideas here. So let me kind of summarize some of the stuff we looked at since we didn't meet last week. It's more important how you deal with the situation than that you deal with the situation. Okay, so anytime you're done with conflict, anytime you're done with people, it's more important how you act in that conflict than it is that there is no conflict. Okay, because what we do, if there's a conflict, we try to instantly resolve it, get it out of the way. Okay, but what God cares a lot more about is how we are conducting ourselves, because there is always going to be conflict, and you have to, for this, it's kind of difficult, especially people like me, because you have to learn how to put people before tasks. Okay, when you follow Jesus' ministry, people were before tasks, and when you follow a lot of modern pastors such as myself, it's typically task before people. So obviously, there's a huge problem there with not seeing people with the same value that God sees them with. People have to come before tasks. Very difficult to do. It's easy to get, okay, this is all the stuff we have to get done. You know, get out of my way if you're in the way. And that's just not really the heart of Christ. Another thing is, when I say it's important how you deal with it, dealing with people with patience. Now, we're going to look at a few key passages that we looked at for the past couple weeks, so I'm just going to kind of highlight some stuff. But these are, you see a lot of this in Galatians, Ephesians, Corinthians, where Paul is continually talking to the churches that are having these problems with one another. And he constantly is, you know, bring these things back up to light. And patience is one of those things that he mentions over and over and over again. Everybody talks about the love chapter in 1 Corinthians, and they always have it for their wedding, which is fine. But the context there is talking about how church members treat each other. Love is patient. Love is kind. Are you being patient with another and kind? Another thing that I think all of us have a little bit of a hard time with is really coming to grips with the fact that it doesn't have to be our way. I know myself, I know it's a human problem. You get something in your head, this is the way you want it to be, and just it's hard to get past that. And but what I want to specifically focus in on before we get to the list of the do list and whatnot, because a couple weeks ago, months ago, we looked at the don't list. Now we're going to look at the do list. And before we get to that, I want to kind of look at the concept of how your response changes you. And I'm going to tell a little story to kind of get this across. There were these two druggies, and they've been doing drugs, you know, for years. And they got together, and they were going to get married. Well, after they got married, one of them ended up getting saved, stopped doing drugs. They had kids, but the one, the husband, was still doing drugs. And so the wife, you know, she grew stronger and stronger in the faith. She got where she was well connected, had good friends. Things were definitely looking, you know, looking up for her. And eventually what happened is he started cheating on her a lot. And rather than just divorcing or separating or whatever, she decided to also cheat, match his stupid with her own stupid. I mean, isn't that what we do? We get in fights with our spouses and we try to see who can do the most stupid, right? And so she starts cheating with some people. And what happened is it changed her. See, she could have divorced, could have separated, could have done anything, but instead she decided to cheat. And when she decided to do that, it changed who she was inside. What we do is we think, I'm a pretty good person, so I can handle this poorly because I'm a good person. But when we handle it poorly, it changes our heart. It's these little compromises that we make where the Holy Spirit is trying to work in us, and we just don't really let him. And we're going to look at this in Matthew 18 in just a second. But so then what happened when she started cheating, she also started drinking drinking and smoking again. And then when she started drinking and smoking again, she also started to you know, have a bad attitude, started to be fake all the time, kicked her son out of the house. It started to be a spiral. And it all started with cheating. Well, it's okay because my husband cheated first. I hear what you're saying, but when you take those steps, your response to the bad situations in your life, it changes you. I don't see any evidence that Judas was always Judas. It seems to me like he made a bunch of series of compromises that typically revolved around greed, and then those kind of just climaxed with Jesus' betrayal. And the final straw that broke the camel's back is she conned her own mother and father-in-law into giving her a loan, and then completely just, it was just a terrible situation. But the thing I want you to get from this is that she at one point had been genuine. She wasn't a fake Christian. At one point she had been genuine, but she made these little compromises because she convinced herself, I'm good enough, I've done the right thing for so many years, it's okay if I do the wrong thing. It's okay. And when we deal with conflict with other people, we do something very, very similar. There'll be somebody who's living in sin, and we say little things. It's okay that I'm talking bad about them because I was the one who was right. It's okay that I'm looking at stuff on the internet that I shouldn't be looking at because my wife has been distant to me. See, we have these little compromises that we make, and it sounds good in our head, but I think our fatal flaw is that we don't talk with other people about what's going on there. I remember there was a situation I had to deal with, and it was very, very stressful. Surprisingly, I actually resolved it well, but after I resolved it, I got extremely bitter. See, I handled the situation well and with grace, and then afterwards I got bitter. And your response changes. So let's look at the do list here, and we'll kind of go to Matthew 18 here on just a couple points here. Whenever we're dealing with conflict, there needs to be three do's that we always do. Number one is our motive. Our motive has to be for their best interest. Whatever we do, we need to be doing it for the sake of the person. Okay? I've been in a lot of different church situations where it wasn't about restoring the person. It wasn't about seeing them do well. It wasn't about seeing them growing in Christ. It was about winning an argument. It was about being right. It was about trying to make somebody look like an idiot. It wasn't really about anything to do with their best interest in mind. If you look at Matthew 18:15, which we read week after week after week, let's look at this. If he listens to you, the brother that you are trying to correct, you have won your brother. Not the argument, you've won your brother. And a lot of times, if we're being honest, we're just really prideful and arrogant. We want to be right in every single situation. And when somebody says something, we just want to be right. We don't care about who gets in the way. We just care about that I got my way. You know what I mean? I guess that we could talk more about that another time. But whatever you do, you have to do it to win them. Your prize, your reward that you get is your brother or sister in Christ being restored to God. That's your reward. Are we working for that reward, or are we working for our own ego? And if I am honest with myself, I find most of the time I put the task over the person. I mean, that's just my natural inclination. I would rather have a day where I say, look at all the things I ticked off, rather than look at all the people who I impacted and, you know, had an impact on their life. We typically gear our lives that way. We like to look things that we can kind of tally. I told you a couple months ago about that pastor who had that board member that was doing illegal things and how he was being so patient and how I was so irritated with the situation. But the thing was, the pastor was doing it with the motive of trying to help the person. And that's the thing. Should he have handled it differently? I don't know, but his motive was good. His motive was trying to restore somebody. So then the second part of the to-do list is our attitude. Whatever we do, we have to do it with the right attitude. And the attitude should be one of restoring, one of me caring. Talk to them as if you cherish them, as if you want to restore them, rather than, I'm done with them. I'm just done. You know, I've dealt with them. They're toxic. I'm just done with them. See, there's a whole different mindset that goes with that. And so the two things, motive, that's kind of like the reason why I'm doing something. Attitude is more like my heart while I'm doing it. They're very similar, but they are very much so different. One thing that always gets me is that, you know, Jesus let go of a lot of things Judas did. Judas didn't just betray him. He'd been doing other things. The Gospels tell us that. But you don't really see Jesus addressing every single issue. There's issues that he did address, such as they said, hey, who's the greatest? And, you know, but then there's other things that he doesn't really mention anything about. And I think that's kind of significant that, you know, not everything always has to be addressed right now. So if we look at the different contexts of, remember, we were looking at, hey, if your brother's caught in sin, you know, go to him one-on-one. But then we looked at, I think it was 2 weeks ago, we looked at the verses before and the verses afterwards. And one of the verses before talk about the shepherd looking for his one lost sheep. And we talked about the way that that one lost sheep was a Christian who had gone astray, not just somebody who had never been saved. And the story ends, it is not the will of your Father in heaven that one of these little ones perish. God doesn't desire that they perish. He doesn't desire that they get what they deserve. And then in the story that follows, it was talking about how there was a servant who owed a great deal of money, and his master forgave him, but that servant turned around and didn't forgive another servant. And that story ends, so also my heavenly Father will do to you unless every one of you forgives his brother or sister from your heart. Talking about the way that that master turned around and punished the first servant. And as we're reading these two stories, we're really able to see God's heart whenever correction is being brought. It's one where he actually does desire that our motive and our attitude in the situation is right. He doesn't just care that we do all the things. He cares about what our heart is when we're doing the thing. And that's, I think, what separates good pastors from great pastors. Great pastors genuinely care. Good pastors are just good at getting stuff done. And I think that it's one of those things that it's a lifelong pursuit, you know. I'm continually reminded of how well Virginia handled her situation when she was attacked, you know, constantly forgiving, constantly saying things, you know, to the attacker about how, hey, I forgive you, God forgive you, over and over and over again. That kind of a heart is exactly the kind of heart that I'm talking about, where somebody's doing something that is so heinous, so, you know, in need of correction, and yet is handled with such grace. So then the third do list of the do list, you've got motive, you know, your underlying reason for what you're doing, attitude, your behavior, your mindset while you're doing it. And then you got action, which could be also called your execution, how you follow through on it. And that's something that I think, ooh, it's hard, guys, because if I had to say it, I would say it like this. Action is more about saying something in a way that won't cause unnecessary offense. And so you walk this fine line between sugarcoating and being abrasive and arrogant. It's a very hard line to find. And that line is wisdom. And if you go to Proverbs 15:2, it talks about this. The mouth of the wise makes knowledge appealing, but the mouth of a fool belches out foolishness. Some other translations, the mouth or the words of the wise makes knowledge appealing or pleasant. One said acceptable. Another one said attractive. It makes it attractive, but the mouth of a fool belches out foolishness. This means that you're giving thought to what you're saying. You're not just shooting off whatever comes to your head. Even if you're right, you're still supposed to say it wisely. And I think that's one of the problems that we all kind of have, because we're more concerned if whether I am right or whether I'm wrong, not so much as am I relaying that truth to you in a wise way. Think about teenagers, right? They go out. Should you be doing that with that girl? Oh, we aren't doing anything wrong. Well, no, not yet you aren't. But you're not really being wise with what you're doing. You're alone in a car at night. I mean, that's just not smart. That's not a smart thing. So, no, you're not doing something immoral yet, but you're getting awful close to it. You know, and I think that's one of the things with Christians. We have, I'm right. I've got the truth on my side. But we need to have wisdom on our side too, not just the truth. And that's difficult, very difficult. So three ways that I think of how we need to have wisdom. The first is in witnessing. It's so easy when we're witnessing to people to just be a little bit aggressive when we're witnessing rather than dialogue, talking with them one-on-one. another way that I think we lack wisdom is in restoring or correction. So there's someone who's caught in sin, and you're trying to, you know, work through the issue. And then the last one is when somebody is giving a word, whether it's a real word from God or not, it's not really not really relevant for what I'm saying. The idea that I'm trying to get across is sometimes we're giving somebody a word and we kind of just don't really try to make it understandable. We just kind of say what we're going to say and then dart away before they have a chance to talk with us and process it. You know what I'm talking about? Have you ever had somebody do this? They go up to you and they say, hey, I have a word from God, and then they just throw it on you and then leave. You don't have any chance to process or ask a question or what? Just gone. And let's look at a question here. In times, think in your past when you have been in conflict with somebody, okay? So just think about your biggest life conflicts. What were the results that you had when you had a bad attitude when you were dealing with a conflict? So what were the results when you had a bad attitude when dealing with a conflict? Anybody want to share on that? You were dealing with a conflict and you had a bad attitude going into it. What were the results? What was that? Yeah. I seem to remember a verse that comes to mind. The anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Anybody else? Todd said, it seems sometimes like that you've reached a resolution, but the conflict oftentimes is still there. Very true. Sometimes people are just so uncomfortable with the conflict themselves that they'll say whatever as long as you stop talking with them. And then once you kind of walk away, they're like, oh, thank God that's over. Anybody else? You went and tried to resolve a conflict while you had a bad attitude. Are you guys not aware that you had a bad attitude, or you just didn't resolve the conflict? I was working with a pastor one time, and he wanted me to go with him for whatever reason. I didn't say a word. I just stood there the whole time. And he was talking, and how did he say it? Man, I wish I could remember his words. But basically, he said it in a very aggressive way where it just kind of escalated things. And I was just standing there awkwardly like, why am I here for this? Whoa! And so then I was kind of like trying to pretend like I wasn't paying attention, but my face was kind of red. And so it's kind of awkward and hard to hide from that. Then there was I remember there was one time where I was like, okay, let's work this through. I had my game face on. I was ready to address it. It was going to rock. And they got madder at the end of that conversation than they were at the beginning because it was obvious I didn't really care about them. I mean, it was obvious from the get-go. The whole look on my face, the way I was talking, it was just painfully obvious. This person, they don't care. And one thing I want to ask, and I don't want to, this is not an answer question, it's just kind of a question for you to reflect on. Did you care whether you talked to them loving? Did you care whether you were talking to them in a loving way? Because, when I did that, I didn't care. I cared whether they saw that I was right and that they backed off. So there are some typical instigators. And any time that you are dealing with conflict, there's at least four instigators that we're going to look at. There's probably other ones, but these are the ones I want to mention. The first one I call the Strobel effect. It's where you're just trying to win an argument. I started calling it the Strobel effect because people started reading books by Lee Strobel and other popular Christian apologists. Lee Strobel was the guy that wrote The Case for Christ, yes, and The Case for Miracles, and The Case for Grace, and The Case for Easter, and there was a bunch of different things that he wrote. But moral of the story being, what I've seen a lot of Christians do is they read the books, and then they just instantly go and say, who can I beat over the head with this? They don't really internalize it too much. You don't try and combat it and kind of like reflect on it. Like, okay, so he's saying this. What's some counterpoints that I could say? How can I learn from this? How can I apply it to my life? Instead, just kind of using it as ammunition for YouTube comments. I've seen that a lot. Sometimes Facebook comments. And so it's more about winning arguments. And all that this really does is it instigates the conflict. It makes it where it's going to get more. The second thing that I've seen is where people just try to get one over on them. they try to, you know, try to not so much one up them as what's another way of saying that? Of having the holding the leash in the argument. I don't know how else to say it. Now I have them where I want them. Ha ha ha. So it's kind of where you twist what was said by the person to just so you can kind of be the person who's right. It's where you kind of maybe sometimes spread rumors or innocently, accidentally insinuate that they did something wrong. Whoops, did I let that slip? And the whole while you're just like kind of using it as extra bait. A good example of this would be in the book of Ezra in the Bible. The Israelites are trying to rebuild Jerusalem. This is good. And then there's some people who come up and they say, hey, can we help? Well, that sounds good, except that they were actually the enemies of Israel and they were kind of not really genuine. And so Ezra and the leaders of Israel, they say, no, we're good. We got it. Thanks, though. And and so then the people say, well, then we hate you. And they do everything in their power to come against Israel and to make it, you know, just a pain for them. And it does not go well. And that's kind of what I'm talking about. They really weren't on their side at all. Not really at all. So they were really just trying to get one over on them. Hey, I helped you with that project. Now you owe me. It's okay if you worship our gods with us because we helped you worship your god. Okay. So then the next one, when you see yourself as more spiritual, any time that you go to a situation with spiritual arrogance, it's not going to go well. Don't walk into any situation believing that you got it all figured out. I mean, especially as it applies to God and the Bible and that kind of stuff. You'd be surprised how many times you're going to look like an idiot. You can kind of force people to kind of back down by your demeanor, but that doesn't mean that you're right. It just means people don't argue with you. I remember I used to, when I first started my young adult class, this was years ago, there, I feel stupid about it now, but I remember I just tried to argue long enough and loud enough until people would be quiet and kind of, you know, let it go. You know what I mean? And now that I'm older, I kind of see what I was doing. When I was younger, I had all kinds of excuses for it, you know, but what it comes down to is I wasn't really interested in what they had to say. And so I always saw myself as more spiritual. Well, but we never say it like that. Oh, I'm more spiritual than you. We don't say that. We always use like other words like, oh, well, he's just not there yet. Translation, I'm there, but he has not yet achieved my level. They need to get their act together, man. They need to get their act together. It's okay for me to be prideful or arrogant or tactless in how I'm talking because I'm right. If they were right, they could also talk like this, but they're not, obviously, since we don't agree. You know what I mean? Don't look at me like you have no idea. Do you guys never get in arguments with people ever? Okay, so you know what I'm talking about. In 2 Corinthians, Paul actually gets a little bit, I guess you'd call it funny. Some of it comes across in the English, but it's funnier in the Greek than it is in the English. He's talking about these, he calls them super apostles. And the way that he's talking about them is just like super sarcastic. I'm surely not as good as these super apostles that you guys have. And it's just really funny to see how he talks about it. But the basic idea is, you know, I'm the more spiritual one. And you see sometimes this happen in marriages, right? There'll be that one who's like, I'm the spiritual one, and my spouse is just kind of a little bit of a, you know, they need to get their act together. And what we really mean to say is, I read my Bible and go to church, so I have the full authority in anything spiritual in this house. And I remember there was this guy that I had. This was a situation I handled very poorly, so do not do as I do, okay? This was a very big mistake how I did this. I'm telling you this because it was funny. I had a friend, and he talked very arrogant, harsh, rude to people who weren't saved. And I guess in his mind he was being a prophet and helping them to come to God or something, but he never actually saw anybody get saved that way. I asked him one time, I said, how many people have you led to Christ like that? Well, none. They just can't handle the truth. I remember that movie, You Can't Handle the Truth. when the truth was, he just didn't have wisdom in his delivery. He wasn't talking to people with wisdom. He was talking to them like they were less than people. Anytime you talk down to people, they're not going to listen to anything you have to say. Just because you've got the truth doesn't mean that you can talk to people, you know, with disrespect. I mean, you talk to people with respect. That's just how you do, you know. And, well, anyways, he would go off on these tangents and everything. And so one time, I got the smart idea. I don't know what I was thinking, guys, but I got the smart idea that I was going to talk to him like he talked to them. And so I did. And it ended as poorly as you would imagine it went. And long story short, we aren't actually friends today. I said sorry. I tried to rectify the situation. I was like, look, I was just trying to show my point that you weren't talking to people very wisely. And it did not work. So don't do that. We've learned lessons. We have learned lessons. And I think we all have those stupid stories in our repertoire, don't we? Yeah, but anyways, and so it did not go well. The Bible actually says that if you're really, truly spiritual, restore people. Galatians 6:1 says this, brothers and sisters, if someone is overtaken in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual, restore such a person with a gentle spirit, watching out for yourself so that you also won't be tempted. So then that brings us to the last of the four instigators, things that always make conflict worse when you try to do drive-bys. Now, I already mentioned how people do this with giving words. You know, oh, well, this is a word from God, goodbye. But we do the exact same thing with correction, too. You need to stop doing this. It's a sin. Goodbye. Instead of like, hey, how you doing? You know, let's talk about this, you know, kind of being real with them. We just kind of drive by, hey, you got this that you need to fix, and goodbye. You know what I mean? That's not really, I don't think that's really what the Bible has in mind. when it's talking about restoring, it's more of a personal one-on-one thing. You are talking to someone that you care about. You're talking to them from your heart and from God's heart. And you are trying to leave the situation resolved. You're trying to make it where they win, you win, everything's fine. And it doesn't really work like that very often, but that's what the goal is. So next week we'll look at the idea of what it means to love. And there's some key verses that I think really apply to correction. And we're about done with this series. Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you that it has everything that we need for our faith and our daily life. I thank you that it is like spiritual food to us and like a cleansing to our soul, God, inside of us. I thank you, Lord, that you have revealed your word to us that we can have it and nourish from it. God, I pray you'd give us wisdom and discretion. Help us as we resolve conflicts, as we heal our families, as we heal our children, as we heal our ministries, as we heal our lives, that we always do it with really your heart in all things, God. I pray you'd give us a gentle spirit and one of kindness. And God, we just thank you for everything you're doing. Amen.